of adventures for Doctor Who from BBC Worldwide in books.
Interesting stuff, isn't it?
And on video. And on audio.
Right, fire away, I'm ready.
For his many fans. Range of books featuring doctors from the past. The first doctor.
We are wanderers in the fourth dimension of space and time.
The second doctor.
I imagine you have orders to destroy me.
The third.
Why should I want to talk to a machine?
The fourth.
There's no one interested in history.
The fifth.
I should have realized.
The sixth.
This looks familiar.
And the seventh doctor.
Time
for a new range of novels featuring the Eighth Doctor. Encountering many foes and friends from the past. And who knows what lurks around the corner.
Hello.
On audio. And on video. Dimension of adventures for Doctor Who, only from BBC Worldwide.
The 35th anniversary of Doctor Who just might be my favorite of all the anniversaries. And I know you're thinking to yourself, the 35th? What? There wasn't even a series on at that point. And yeah, I would say that. It was before the series returned in 2005. It was before Big Finish started. But I personally think that the 35th anniversary of the show gave us some very special releases for that year, and to me had shown how powerful the Doctor Who brand was when there was not a show that was supporting it. But yet, it had revitalized itself with a brand, taking one TV movie with Paul McGann and turning it into something, I think, turning the brand, I should say, into something very stellar, created a whole new line of books. A couple differentiations of the books as well. And it was really, really cool. And I have so many fond memories of that time period. And in my view, released perhaps one of the best VHS releases of Doctor Who is the Ice Warriors. And I am so happy to be talking about this release today. I've been wanting to talk about this release for so long. In fact, I should have held back on this a little bit because, you know, we started this whole video series with a Troughton. We kind of seem to be sticking in the first three Doctor area. I couldn't wait. I love this release. I'm not a big fan of the story itself, funny enough. I find that the story is very loud. Anyone else feel like it's loud? I don't mean like the volumes around. Everyone on that base is always yelling. And it just was really off-putting for me. So that was from the very first time I saw the story back in 1990. We'll get to that in a second. Once again, I'd like to invite everybody, if you are able to do so, to join my Patreon. The Patreon, you can sign up at different levels. This truly helps me. To have people sign up and support the work I do. And I know there's so many of you out there who like what I'm doing. I know that money is tough. If you can't do it, obviously you can't do it. But to sign up at different levels unleashes different categories and different rewards and stuff. And the higher up you go, like all the paperwork that we show throughout all these are up on Patreon at a specific level that you could download and add to your own personal archive. And a chance to decide maybe what the next release is for this. And don't forget, I do have non-Doctor Who videos in the works. I've just been having so much fun doing these that I've been focusing on these. But please consider joining up on Patreon. Now, also, as usual, if I get something wrong here, please, you know, send me a polite note. You can do so at the address below here, and you can just let me know or let me know what you think. I also have been really loving the way that people share their experiences of not only how they got, like, these releases, but also how they maybe watch the stories. Now, I don't know how many of you are going to say that they watch the Ice Warriors on transmission, but if you have seen it, fantastic. That would be great. But I really wanted to spend time today and talk about how special this release is for me. Now, to start with, when I became a fan of Doctor Who in 1984, the Ice Warriors wasn't known to exist. Right now, at that point, it was all like, you know, if you look at a listing of archive stories in 1984, there'd be nothing from the Ice Warriors. Episodes of the Ice Warriors were found in 1988, and they were found at a clean-out of Villiers House, which is BBC Enterprises. And according to Broadcast Who, which I have to always thank for having such great information on there, according to Broadcast Who, basically the labels on the can said cutting copies. And the exact origin of these, quote, cutting copies are unknown. During the mastering of the restoration work for the DVD release of the story, no edits or missing segments were identified, so these cutting copies were uncut. Now, I'm a little bit surprised, to be honest, that it took for them to the DVD to kind of figure that out, but I think what ends up happening after a while is, you know, you just have them and you just want to put them out, right? You just want to put them out on video, and maybe when they did the VHSs, they didn't really check it, where I think now, because there had been some, like, off-air recordings found and stuff, I think just by how it works, Mark Ayers always compares it to what they have as their probably their master version. If I'm not mistaken, an episode of Keys of Marinus found that there was, like, an extra, I don't know, couple seconds, 7 seconds, something like that. And you might be like, well, you know, wow. It's all about, and this is what I love about what these people do, it's all about getting Doctor Who back to as close to broadcast as possible. And, you know, it's amazing how those type of quality copies, like broadcast, you know, as broadcast copies, are very few and far between, actually. Some are perfectly the way that they were for broadcast, and others are not. So I find that to be really a wonderful thing that the restoration team is doing. A few things happen that would have a strong effect on not only this release, but then a lot of other things going forward, which were very important. For example, in 1996, Damien Shanahan had found out that ABC Australia was holding censor clips. Dubbed Australian censor clips, this provided us with footage from episodes that no longer existed. It also helped in footage that were excised from episodes that did exist, such, for example, as we had shown, the War Machines. So with that, it was helping, once again, putting these episodes back together as the best broadcast version, close to the broadcast as possible. And that's what I love about restoration, taking all these different formats and all these different type of qualities of formats and putting them together to create something that we hope is seamless, right? These clips that were found by Damien, they don't necessarily help the Ice Warriors release per se, but they get a really nice showing in the second tape that we're going to talk about on this release, the Missing Years documentary. And so that was a very big part of that. So another part about this release is by the time this release came out, Doctor Who soundtracks for every missing episode was known to exist by this point. Now, earlier in the 90s, I don't think that, at least I certainly didn't know that it existed for everything. And that would take from a number of audio recordists who did so at different times of transmission, ends up in different countries as well. But certainly by 1998, all of fandom, if you cared to know about it, were aware of what we called crystal clear audios. And this was really from Graham Strong, mainly, his recordings that he made, and that they set up distribution sites around the country where from Graham, or maybe from somewhere just one step below from Graham, a bunch of copies were made of each episode. And then that those were the sites, the distribution sites. So then people would send a blank audio cassette tape and some postage. That's all. No money for the time or anything. And kind souls would simply just make copies of these recordings and send them back. And the purpose for how to do it this way was, you know, when I got into tape trading of any kind, it was very much like you get one person who has everything and it goes down the line. So by the time I get something and we've seen the quality of the episodes, by the time I get something, it's really, it's a very poor quality. And that's what we got for the audio. I'm hoping to go more into the audio portion of this in some other episode, because I really would love to share my quality, my copies of Marco Polo, as it happened, because they were pretty horrific. They were pretty nasty, actually. But it was really interesting that these recordings, we'd still listen to them. But then the people who were kind of behind putting all this together for the crystal clear audios, they simply wanted to make sure everyone had a chance to get high quality recordings. And I remember, you may know, I'm kind of a fan of the story of the 10th Planet. And I recall getting something, a number of them actually, from a gentleman by the name of Brian. And Brian, and he sent me that, I think Savages and some other stuff. And it was like listening to just this recording that was just as good as what could be on air. And didn't have any video, but boy, how amazing it sounded. And the fact that I could get audio for the Savages or the Smugglers, you know, early in the 90s, 1991, 92, and we talked about it with Tomb of the Cybermen, that John Pertwee did a narrated version of Tomb of the Cybermen soundtrack, but Tom Baker also did Evil of the Daleks, I believe Power of the Daleks, and was it Fury from the Deep? I only have Evil of the Daleks. And they were fine, but then they weren't also released proper episodic. You know, BBC had to make it so it's like Omnibus, one side of the tape only had, you know, put those episodes together and all that stuff, whatever. But the idea that you could listen to the massacre was pretty incredible. And the fact that I work with a group called Kaleidoscope, and we found those tapes called the Randolph tapes. That is pretty amazing stuff. And to hear those, which I have, because I have them all, and compare them with Graham Strong's, I mean, thank God for all these wonderful people that preserved our shared history, right? And so, and the Randolph tapes are brilliant. I would expect that you're going to hear, if you haven't heard them on like Underwater Menace, I don't know if they were on there or not, but I would suspect that parts of it, because they have the continuity at the end, will come from the Randolph tapes. And so it was really pretty extraordinary. So a long story long, it's exciting that, once again, this release is making use of those audios, because it released, first of all, when we talk a little bit about the Missing Years documentary, those audios were often used to kind of bridge any sort of cuts or anything in some of those clips, which is fantastic. And they just sound so great. And I remember how exciting all this was at the time. And this was really, truly incredible. Not only did you have the clips being put into the missing episode documentary, but we got a CD of the complete episode 2 and 3 of the Ice Warriors, because of what needed to be done with the visual portion of it, because they didn't exist. So we have, once again, we have this footage from 1996 that Damien had found. We had the discovery of all the crystal clear audios and making them available for everyone to be able to enjoy. And then the final piece of it is the Telesnaps. One of my favorites. So between the find of Tomb of the Cybermen in 1991 with a release in 1992 to 1999, there are no other, because 1999 is the find of the Lion, the first episode of the Crusades. There are no full missing episodes to be found. And I remember at the time hearing fans saying, well, geez, you know, nothing was found. This is kind of, what a streak of bad luck, basically. Keep in mind that, you know, in the 80s, I think we were doing, you know, averaging about an episode a year of Doctor Who being found once Sue kind of took things over and started to bring stuff in. I mean, that's to be expected, but that wasn't going to last forever. The last find of the 80s, I believe, would be the Ice Warriors here. What we have here, which is fantastic, is simply this. Between 1994... and this release, we had the distribution set up of these crystal clear audios. Damien finding all of these missing episode clips. And then the Telesnap. We knew about Telesnaps for a while. I knew about them in the 80s. I think the Telesnaps for episode 1 of Power of the Daleks is reproduced in this kind of like strange way at the end of the Doctor Who the earlier years book, which, I mean, is kind of signaling, you know, the Hartnell era is over, Troughton's beginning. I remember having no idea what that was. I knew that Power of the Daleks did not exist, so why do we have stuff that looks like film strip? You know, what was that? I had no idea about it. And then I remember, and I brought this up before too, that going to a local comic shop, that DWB did this photo novel of the Power of the Daleks, which blows my mind at the time, and had to get it. I just pored over all those pictures, and they would publish in line all the strips, and then they would also publish the larger reproductions, because remember that's how they would show up. That's how most of them were done by John Cura at the time. Now, I have seen Telesnaps, and they are, I mean, they are truly very small. You know, I mean, I can't believe how small these things are. And there's a picture of me holding one in London, or in Birmingham in the UK at Kaleidoscope, and just like wow. But they are, you look at them, you can see so much detail on them. They're photographs, and they're fantastic. And so we knew about Power of the Daleks. You know, there was also in DWB, I believe that they published the Moon Base, but something happened. And that was in 1994, two separate researchers were going into the written archives of the BBC and found something which was pretty incredible. And so I thought it'd be nice to get Marcus Hearn, who is one of the folks that did the discovery. I thought it would be nice for him to tell us all about it. Take a look.
The Ice Warriors is the first Telesnap reconstruction of sorts that was officially released. I know they did a lot more to it than just a Telesnap, but I figured that's a good inroad. And I feel like, you know, a lot of this stuff gets forgotten over time. The fact is that fans like me and obviously you, there was a time that these Telesnaps we didn't know they existed at all. Now all this stuff is out there for everyone to really enjoy. And I really, instead of me just talking about how they were found, I was really hoping that you could just walk through your experience of being in the written archives. I know that Stephen James Walker was on a similar track at the same time. So the find is kind of, you know, it's kind of both ways, but I wanted just to talk about that, you know. And also, if I may, I'd like to start by talking about a little bit about the BBC written archives, because I don't know if it's changed at all over the course of since you've been, you know, doing your research there in the 90s. But I mean, just the act of getting the files and stuff was kind of very painstaking sort of situation, because you'd have to know what to look for and ask for it. And it sounds like that is exactly why no one knew about the Telesnaps.
Well, we're going back quite a long way now, over 30 years, I think.
Right, and yeah.
I started on Doctor Who magazine as the editor. Well, I started on Doctor Who magazine as a writer in 1989, but I started as the editorial assistant in very early 1993. And as far as I remember, it was Andrew Pixley, the magazine's archivist, who told us about the Written Archive Center. But I don't know how easy it was to gain access to the place at that time. As far as I remember, it was a lot more difficult to gain access to the Written Archive Center at that time than it subsequently became. But Andrew was very keen to get information, or at least to find out what was actually being held at the Written Archive Center. But he didn't know how to gain access to it. Now, of course, being Doctor Who magazine, we were a licensee. And so that obviously gave us an advantage. Another advantage that we had was that the editor at the time, Gary Russell, actually knew a lady called Jackie Kavanagh, who was at that time running the Written Archive Center. And as far as I remember, we gained access because Gary wrote to Jackie, because he'd worked with her at the BBC. And so he spoke to Jackie, and then Jackie wrote back to him, and I believe it was Jackie who allowed us in.
Okay.
And so it was a combination of, Terence Dix once said, Terence Dix once memorably said that people say it's not what you know, it's who you know. He always said, that's not true. It's actually both. It's what you know and who you know. And I think this is a classic example of that, really. And so we were licensees, and Gary had worked with Jackie before, and it was her that allowed us access. And as far as I was aware, we were the first licensees in there. And I don't know exactly when I started going in there. It was certainly, I made my first visit there in early 93. And I think I was on my second or third visit when I found the Telesnap files.
The act of actually finding the actual files that you want to talk about or want to look for, that seemed to be kind of a sort of like a game of luck sometimes, because you couldn't actually go and look through a bunch of files at once, right?
I haven't been there for many years, but I believe it's still the same. You're not allowed, no researchers and archivists are not, or our researchers are not allowed to look through what I believe they call the stacks. Mm-hmm. They are held, you know, as a researcher, you are, or you were, allowed into a particular room. You were not allowed to, I don't think, to take a pen. Can you take a pencil? I think. You certainly couldn't photograph anything, so you couldn't bring a camera in, and there were no mobile phones in those days. Mm-hmm. And I also remember that you had to take enforced breaks. You had to take enforced tea breaks, at which point you were led from the room, and you were sat in a little sort of ante room, and you were given tea and biscuits, and you were given tea in a cup and saucer, and you munched your biscuits and sipped your tea while sitting beneath a portrait of Lord Reith, the first Director General. And I'm not making this up. This actually happened. And it was lovely. It's a charming place. It's one of the greatest places in the whole world. And I cherish my visits at the beginning. They had a little display case there we went in of, like, some of the notable things that they had, they discovered in their archives. I remember one of them was a letter that Brian Jones had written to the BBC, where he introduced his group, which he described as the Rolling Stones, and asked for the opportunity to audition at the BBC. That's one of the handwritten letters that they actually had on display in a glass case. Wow. And I was astonished to see things like this.
Right.
But yeah, it's quite strict. And so it's almost like exam conditions. And so you're led into this room and you have a pencil and paper and you're allowed to make notes, but you weren't given permission to actually examine the stacks. You could request things. And then your inquiry's assistant would then disappear into the stacks and emerge with a trolley. And you could request, I think, 5 files at a time. As I said, I was on my second or third visit there, and while it was, I was discovering all sorts of fantastic things, seeing all the pre-production documents from 1962 and 1963 for the first time, which were astonishing. I was very grateful for the chance to go there, but I was also getting slightly frustrated because it was almost, I didn't know what to ask for because I didn't know what they had. Right. That was the thing. And so I didn't know. And so you would ask for things. And by the time my third visit, it was getting to the stage where sometimes things weren't appearing because they didn't exist. And you'd be looking at your watch thinking, well, you know, the clock would be ticking down to 5 o'clock or whatever. And you'd be thinking, oh, well, I've just spent, you know, however long it is waiting for something that wasn't actually there. I'll try something else. And so I was given, I did meet Jackie briefly. I do remember Jackie, but mainly I worked with a fantastic guy called Neil Somerville, who was my inquiries assistant. And I think it was on my third visit. I think it was towards the end of my third visit. I said to him, look, this is great, everything that you're showing me, but I don't know what you have and what you don't have. I mean, is there a list? I should have asked for it earlier, really, in hindsight, but is there a list of what you actually have relating to Doctor Who? And he said, yes, absolutely. And he came back with a folder with printouts on it. They were done on the old daisy wheel printers, if you remember. And there was a list of all the Doctor Who files that were on there. And they were, it all looked like very prosaic stuff. Remember, there were files marked finance. There were definitely finance files on there. And then at the bottom of this list, seemingly out of place, because I seem to remember that the list wasn't alphabetical at the end. I could be wrong. At the bottom of this list, I just saw an entry for Telesnaps, serials Z to UU. And I was astonished. And I said to Neil, could you find this file for me? And he said, well, okay. And so he disappeared beyond the door, beyond the magic door, and then returned from the stacks with this file. It's a huge, outsized scrapbook. And as I started flicking through it, my jaw dropped. And he said to me, what are these? And obviously I knew what telesnaps were because I'd seen some reproduced in DWB. Mm-hmm. Christopher Barry ones, Power of the Daleks, and so on. And I said something. I said something like, I said, Neil, these are incredible. These are the only visual record of, you know, or a very important visual record, at least, of serials that don't exist anymore. And he was, really? Like that. And I remember both of us just flicking through these things together. And I could not believe what I was seeing. Thinking back, I think it must actually have been, it wasn't just before I left that day, it must have actually been late morning. Mm-hmm. I think it was late morning because I then had to take my lunch break and I found a payphone. Because again, there were no mobiles then. Because I do vividly remember calling the Marvel UK office in London and speaking to Gary Russell and saying, you are not going to believe what Neil and I have just seen. And when I told him that I found this scrapbook of Telesnaps, and I remember describing to him what a chameleon looked like. I remember that because I'd never seen a chameleon. And I remember putting the coins in the slot and breathlessly, you know, explaining to him that, you know, I didn't know how many were there, but I said there is a huge scrapbook of these things. At which point, I think he then probably spoke to Jackie, but I can't remember. But they were in a large, very outsized scrapbook, and they were pasted down in strips, and they looked very much like this.
Yep. Okay.
And they were pasted down in this way. Now, these are Telesnaps from the first Dalek serial, but Telesnaps come in several sizes. There are also enlargements, which are obviously much bigger. I don't remember seeing any that look like that, but I do remember that they all looked like this.
Right.
And so at the end of the day, when I'd seen whatever I'd seen, I certainly remember seeing chameleons. I'd spoken to Gary. I think he spoke to Jackie. And then I had to speak to someone there about actually getting these things into the magazine because we wanted people to see them as soon as possible.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know? And at that time, which I said was probably early spring 93, I think we had one Apple Mac in the Doctor Who magazine office in the Marvel, probably in the whole of Marvel UK, actually. There certainly was not a scanner.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. And the idea, obviously scanners did exist, but you had to send photographs off to be scanned by proper professional facilities. And the idea of taking a scanner in there was just absolutely out of the question. I don't think the technology existed. And if it did, it certainly wouldn't have been very good quality. I don't remember using desktop scanners that were in any way remotely portable until probably 3-4 years after that. And even the quality was not very good. And so I remember speaking to one of the ladies there and saying, these are incredible. We really like people to see them. And I think they appreciated my enthusiasm. I hope they did anyway. So I was probably laughing. And I said, how can we get these copied? And I remember she said to me, well, she said, there is a chemist down the road. She said to me, the idea being that they could be the sheets, which are bigger than the one I'm holding up now. Mm-hmm. The idea being that these big sheets could be then photographed and then the film could be developed at the chemist down the road.
Oh, it's, yeah.
Yeah. And so that's what was done, basically. There were the sheets, the actual pages were not by me. The pages were photographed. And then we received the large format negatives of the Telesnaps, and we reproduced them the best we could. Obviously, as technology has evolved over the years, people have been able to get much, much more out of those Telesnaps than we were able to at the time. But at the time, it was just a case of people have got to see these, you know, got to share these as soon as possible. And we did the best we could.
That moment of finding the Telesnaps, and we may take that for granted now a little bit, because they've been around for so long now. They were a massive piece, and I remember not understanding that they'd been found, and I got a copy of DWM at Visions in Chicago. Had it been 94 then, right? Something like that. I don't quite remember. And they were talking about, actually, archive, I think, was Power of the Daleks. And they had an image of a kind of a broken down Cyberman from 10th Planet. And underneath it said the last few minutes or last few seconds before the regeneration or something of the sort. Even at that age, being younger, I knew pretty much all the pictures that existed for 10th Planet. I had never seen anything like it, let alone the fact it looked like it was taken off screen. And that's one of the things that I find really interesting about all of this, is that we were able to get all this wonderful stuff, all these wonderful telesnaps, and DWM did not hold it. They did not hold it at all. They started to publish the telesnaps in DWM, and then they had another magazine going called Classic Comics, and they moved those telesnaps over to Classic Comics to be reproduced. I think they come back over because I don't think Classic Comics lasted, did it? But the fact that they did not hold on to these to themselves, they started to put them out there right away, I think is really very cool and very exciting. And that's the thing, I think that's the thing that Doctor Who fans have been very lucky with. I mean, sure, there was times that episodes were held back because there just wasn't a way to get them out there. But when, look at the lion, look at everything that's been found in the 21st century, it, for the most part, maybe with Underwater Menace Episode 2, everything was made available pretty quickly. Now, that's a backlash, and I'm going to talk about that in a little bit. I think it's a backlash in a sense by what fans get kind of vocal about, at least at the time. So, as we talked about before, Telesnaps, they come in these contact sheets. A lot of work has to be done on them. I'm going to talk about that in a second. But there's also, even that, there's been Telesnap discoveries, okay? For example, was it George Galasho who found Telesnaps? I mean, I think he got a lot of Telesnaps, actually, but ones that actually were for missing episodes for the second and fourth episode of the Crusades. And I think the restoration team only found out about that after the fact, after the release came out. But then, of course, the big one was Marco Polo. How fantastic. And that was one of those great moments of that was found. And I think everything except, let's see, it was episodes 1-3, 5-7, that Christopher Barry had. Christopher Barry did not direct episode 4, therefore he didn't have the telesnaps for that. Makes sense. So it's unfortunate, but at the same time, it's like, wow. And then, of course, George Galasho had for the Knights of Jaffa and the Warlords. So the official BBC website did some good stuff for us. They published on their website pretty much all of the telesnaps, which is pretty cool of them. The problem is, and I don't think many would know this unless you have access to the telesnaps themselves, that they are really overly processed. And I think the belief is that they probably were all run through like a batch process. So like, you know, maybe load up all the imagery for the Crusades, and it just does the same thing to all of them. And it's not great. I mean, it's great that they're there, but it's not great that they are, that they're processed so poorly. And I always found it, I don't know why the 10th Planet episode 4 was not part of that, was not included in that. You know, hopefully when it comes to the release of a series 4 collection set, that would be in there, because we're finding that with, you look at the season 2 set, they're including all the Telesnaps that they have, and that's including for stories that exist. I think that's pretty cool. So you got that, but they also don't have Marco Polo up there, and so everything is you know, it's kind of overly processed. Now, this, you know, I'm not trying to show off or anything, but I do have very high quality scans, recent scans of all the Telesnaps, and I think there are 2 or 4K scans done of the Telesnaps that I was able to get a hold of. They're beautiful. All right, they're beautiful, and they need to have some, you know, they need to have work done with it. So one of the things is that I gave some of these Telesnaps to my friend Robert Franks, who back in the 90s, he used to work on the Telesnap reconstructions through joint venture, also JV, along with Bruce Robinson. And so, you know, I wanted to put together a Telesnap reconstruction of Power of the Daleks, and I don't have the patience to go through each image and clean it up. Robert also had the same sort of like want to do that. So I went ahead and I gave him the Telesnaps for it and all the different sizes and stuff. And what he did was he went through and he cleaned up all the Telesnaps. And so he used his skill as a photo retoucher, and he went through and he retouched everything, and they're superb. I don't think they've ever looked any better. And so he made this Telesnap reconstruction of all 6 episodes of The Power of the Daleks. But what he also did was he made this little video at the beginning of it, showing the work that he has done to clean up the Telesnaps, and also give a little history, especially of Power of the Daleks, because isn't like episode 2 the first known reconstruction, something like that? I know it's from one of the episodes of Power of the Daleks, and so I want to show that. It's a few minutes, and it really, you can really see the work that had gone into all of these Telesnaps that he had done, and you can see how good they look, and know that, you know, I'm sure Derek is putting a lot of work into his releases for, like, the animations when they include the Telesnap reconstructions, but I have always been very impressed with Robert's work. Take a look for yourself. Thank you. That wasn't that cool. So, you know, as I talk in all these videos, and this is actually one of my favorite things about to talk about when I do these videos, simply is that getting like these orphaned episodes, right? Back in the day, called them archive episodes for no good reason. Anyway, that getting these orphaned episodes, and especially at the time that we were getting, like, these things were being found, we were waiting how long before we get them. Faceless Ones, Episode 3, and Evil of the Daleks, Episode 2. It took a while to get them over here. And as I mentioned before, so much of what I had was camera copies. And when I started to really get into it, my goal was to no longer get camera copies and get converted copies as I kind of work my way up the tape trading ladder, which is fine, which makes sense. The problem is finding those people. So, for example, Faceless Ones 3 and Evil of the Daleks 2, we did get converted copies. They were horribly converted. And I'm once again, my tape, my original beta tape of these, I really wish had not been moved with my ex-wife's stuff, because the conversion for Evil the Daleks would be like there'd be strands of lines that magnified parts of the picture. Like, Jamie's eyes would be much bigger than the rest of his body because of that line. It's just one of the most bizarre things I've ever seen. And so, you know, yeah, I was like, well, I got it converted. I mean, that's one thing. For the Ice Warriors, this is going to be a long story. Hopefully it makes sense. For those of you who ever got anything out of the BBC archive, I think this will make sense to you. And that, as far as viewing copies are concerned. Now, Ice Warriors was found in 1988. I myself did not get my first copy of the story until 1990, a little before September, because I ran the video room at a convention called Pseudocon in Roseville, Minnesota. And so I got this tape, and it was a camera copy. And I'm like, oh, for goodness sake, I cannot believe it's a camera copy. And it looks odd. It looks like it's claustrophobic. Like, I'm getting claustrophobia watching it. Everyone is so close. Like, really close. And I, you know, I just, like, I can't understand why this one looks so weird. But it's the Ice Warriors, and I'm going to show it at this convention, and we're going to be lauded for the fact that we showed the Ice Warriors. There we are. And we showed it. And we had a projector. So we projected it up on the screen. And when you have a projector, different from the days of having your CRT televisions, your tube televisions, you could see a little bit more of the picture. And I saw that there's words on the top of the screen. It was still, you know, obviously a camera copy, but there's words like it said, the Ice Warriors. I could see, like, the bottom part of the words on top of the screen, just like a band going across. And I'm like, I don't know what that is, but that's really interesting. Nothing else I've ever had. Like, none of the other orphaned episodes that I had, which are camera copies, had that as well. So, what happens is that maybe just a few months later, it's not that long, I think it's still 90, and I was certainly November of 1990, I meet a guy at Visions. I mean, everybody was at Visions, everybody. And he lived in New Mexico. I think his name was Scott or something like that. Lived in New Mexico, and he's like, I have a converted copy of the Ice Warriors. And I'm like, wow, may I have a copy, please? And he's like, absolutely. And so a few weeks later, he certainly follows through, very kind. He signs everything, BCing you, like literally the letters, BCNU. Anyway, and I don't think I even knew the prisoner at that point. So he, I did actually. Sends me this, and for anyone who's ever gotten something, a viewing copy from the BBC archive, is that all the copies, what I would call burnt-in time code, BITC. I don't think that's what it's called. But, you know, it's like something over the picture that will normally give you like a time code, but it's also an identifier. You know, these are viewing copies. So someone got a viewing copy from the BBC archive of the Ice Warriors, and they made a copy, and that's what started to infiltrate throughout the world. And this had the Burton time code. And here's this. All I have left of this recording is just a screen grab of it. And you can see how bad that recording was. But you can also see the burnt in on the top. It said the title, and on the right and left, there's some BBC TV, VT, and then some other stuff. So if we look at something else that I had received, because I have a ton of recordings like this now, but you look at that, all right, that's when it became clear to me what had happened with my camera copy, that somebody had the episode just as I got the converted one from Scott, and because they thought, well, no one wants to see that burnt in time code stuff, or they're going to say that, well, if we show that, they're going to know where it came from and we might get in trouble. So they zoomed in, so all you could see was this little pocket of the actual screen. And it was a camera copy. It was poor quality. And like I said, the thing about this recording is that, about the Ice Warriors in general, is that it's loud to me. It's really loud. And I was just like, come on. So I was just, it's watching it was not a pleasant experience, to be perfectly honest. And so, like, you know, over time, obviously, was getting better copies of this story. And, you know, you think about it, like 1990, it is actually a fairly long time until you get to 1998 when the story is released. So it took a long time to get some decent quality copies. You know, eventually, you know, I've had people all around the country that I would get copies from at one time. And I even got some stuff from the late Eric Hoffman before even the Hartnell years came out, because he had provided me with nice converted copies of The Celestial Toymaker, The Final Test, as well as The Tenth Planet, episodes 1-3. They looked great. They looked really good. They were actually from Jerry Davis. So Jerry Davis gave them to Eric Hoffman, and Eric Hoffman gave them to me. So they weren't bad. And so, you know, you just kind of, that's what you kind of did, was you just would find more and more good stuff. That was kind of the rarity at the time, to find the good stuff. Someday I really need to go in and explain about all of these orphaned episodes. Now, here's the thing. If I were anybody paying attention, I don't know if you still are, be like, okay, the Ice Warriors had all of these like markings on it. Presumably, all Doctor Who would have that if you got it from the BBC archive. And I have a theory. So we had pretty much so much of Doctor Who that was available, that leaked into the fan consciousness in the 80s. And so my case before you is this. Why don't the other episodes, like the orphan episodes, have that same sort of burnt-in titling on it? Because I believe that the source of those episodes are from Ian Levine. Because remember, Ian bought all the prints back in the day. Sometimes he would lend them out, and I think that's where it all came from. Just remember, he didn't realize that his version of Shada was ever out there in the public until someone brought it up to him. It's a theory, and I even asked him about it. I was going to ask you, you know, one of the things, because I'm eventually going to do a video that's talking about the orphaned episodes of Doctor Who that made its way into the tape trading circuits. And you had all these episodes, you bought them all. Do you think, I've always curious about this, and you may completely disagree with me on this.
know how it happened.
Did it come from your episodes?
Not exactly. No, well, no, certainly not. Richard Landon had put money in Spain, and you know, with his money, I couldn't have bought everything. He and Jeremy chipped in a bit, yep. Right? So he decided he'd get some of his money back by privately selling a few of his copies.
Oh.
And I found out that he got nasty.
Oh, yeah.
So we'll just let that simmer for a little while, see what you all think about that. But I think that that's where especially the Orphan episodes came from, because Ian had bought all of them, and so he had not only them on 3/4-inch U-matic tape, he also had a 16mm film of them as well. Interesting stuff, isn't it? So I said in the War Machines video, I said that this was a very... I said War Machines was the start of a very special time when it came to the branding, when it came to everything else. And I stand by that, obviously, for the Ice Warriors. I think that this was being done at a time that was truly, for me, magical. And, you know, I know that the Wilderness Years takes place, I mean, doesn't that basically take place between the end of Survival to the start of the new series? I suppose some might say from the TV movie to the start of the new series. For me, all it is between... basically 1997 to 1999, specifically 1998, because this brand was refreshed, in my opinion. And I'm not going to go through all of it again like I did with the War Machines, but just know that a new Doctor gave it a new lease of life. They had a whole new range of Eighth Doctor books that they started up. They had a whole new range of past Doctor books that they started up. They were releasing more audios. They were doing videos that were being looked at by the restoration team. They had new covers. Now, granted, you know, some of them, and we'll talk about this in a second, some of them, as we know, are quite garbage, quite frankly, from the rebrand. But everything felt fresh. And once again, for not having a series to anchor it all down, and the fact that so much effort was being put into the Doctor Who brand at that time, to me, is wonderful. And, you know, you think about that opening for the videos that Steve Cole did the Dalek voice. I think he said he did it one morning at 2 a.m. And we showed that at the beginning of this, a little bit of it at the beginning of this release, that it really goes to show they were trying to do something pretty special. And I remember within that promo piece that is at the beginning of the story and everything from that year, seeing, like, they were releasing the E-Space trilogy and so many other great stories, but then seeing a little bit of the quality of the Ice Warriors in there. And that was pretty exciting. That was pretty spectacular for me to finally be able to see this looking as good as possible at the time. So this was, I will always say that this is my favorite time. And I think part of it, too, comes down to simply, my friends and I knew the people putting all this together. We talked last time, Steve Cole, Steve Roberts, a number of the folks putting this together. They were accessible. They were enjoying it. It was before too many people were getting involved with, like, the Restoration Team Forum, who complained about every aspect of everything they were doing. And it was a really kind of a magical time, because we were able to talk about very freely what was going on, how things were working, and we weren't asking for copies of stuff. We just were curious to know what was going on. We knew that it was coming out and stuff, and that was really exciting. And so that's why that's such a wonderful time for me. And now, and I hope I don't make anyone angry by saying this, some of the people who put this stuff together now, not then, but now, kind of know that they have a kind of a bit of a power in that they kind of come across a bit like they like savoring the popularity from it. They like the attention. So be it. If that's what you do, you do you. But they're, you know, they're, I also think that they have no choice in some areas to be on guard when people come talk to them, because sometimes people just destroy confidences, and just like, you know, if someone gives away something, they're going to let everybody know. So I can also see that, but I miss those days that we would all be at the hot tub, you know, or that we could just, you know, chat and not, no one had to worry that we were going to, you know, mess things up by talking about it. Also, Doctor Who wasn't that tight security, you know, as far as information had gone. Now, marketing in general just has changed so much. But I just wanted to mention that because that's partially why this is so important to me. And that's why I love it so much, this period of time. So, very simply put, the radio times for this story was, you know, obviously you had the six episodes had listings, but then you had a preview at the start of the story, which is kind of cool. And then you had kind of a preview of sorts the week of the fourth episode running, which was the Daleks versus Blue Peter. It was talking about the Design the Monster competition, which is pretty cool. And some of that is actually on the Ice Warriors DVD set. As we mentioned before, the episodes were completely wiped from their videotape masters in 1969. It's interesting because, based on what Wiped had said, that episode 4 of the Ice Warriors was slated to be wiped on the 31st of January, 1969. And then the rest of the episodes were slated to be wiped in August of 1969, listing episode 4 again. So I don't know if it was wiped twice. No, it wasn't wiped twice. But, you know, you got to wonder if it was some kind of clerical error. Was it never meant to be wiped in January? I mean, it's only a few months later anyway, so it doesn't really matter. The thing is, now that we have from, you know, the episodes that were found at Villiers House, we have the audio for the two missing episodes and telesnaps for the two missing episodes as well. So, yes, it sucks that anything is missing at all. But comparatively speaking to other BBC programs or other shows that have missing material, you know, we are incredibly lucky compared to what it could have been. Wasn't there also talk, like somebody, and this might have been on the restoration team forum, that somebody was at a school in the 60s at the time of the airing, and that school had a Shabadin video recorder, and that somebody said that that couple episodes of the Ice Warriors were, they know that they were recorded on that. I think that the person immediately said he didn't think that they were kept, because I think they kept reusing the tape for different things. But I'd like to say that that might have been something. God, could you imagine finding a Shabadin tape with some Doctor Who on it? I mean, just recently, Kaleidoscope found those three episodes of Till Death Us Do Part. I mean, honestly, that's pretty cool. Hopefully that maybe someday we might get that. I certainly wouldn't mind seeing episodes of Doctor Who from Shabadin. Better than nothing at all, right? And for the longest time, that's all that existed of My Old Man's Atori from Steptoe and Son. So definitely, you know, who knows what's out there, right? We'll see. Probably not. DWM, for issue 254, it is announced that the Ice Warriors will be going onto VHS, which is pretty cool. 255, it talks about a new documentary that will accompany release, focusing on clips. If I recall, it didn't say anything about it necessarily being a documentary on missing episodes, but about clips, which would have been fine as well. DWM 263 talks about The Underwater Menace Episode 3 being added to the anniversary video. Remember, folks, that this was actually meant to be an anniversary video, just like on the book releases. The Infinity Doctors was getting a release as well. They were really doing an overall tie-in of the brand, and I just have to keep saying that. And I still don't like the diamond logo. So anyway, with that, DWM 264 talks about entire Galaxy 4 sequence being added to the anniversary video. Now that's a big deal. And once again, for those of you who may not realize it, if you came to the series in the 2000s, when stuff was just out there already, this was huge. I mean, this is literally like dreams coming true that that these clips were being included. We knew about the Galaxy 4 clip, at least the 30-second version of it, because it was in Who's Doctor Who. The thing is that this was just a bit of the film that Jan Vincent Rutsky got, and they just asked him if they could have it for the documentary, and he said yes, and they recorded him talking about it a little bit. I mean, we've all heard of it, and I had somebody I knew who was really antsy about getting it, and he thought that myself and a couple other friends had it, and he just really wanted it, and he just was really being persistent about it, a guy named Trevor, and it just was like, if we did have it, and why would we? If we did have it, though, we wouldn't be giving it to you. I don't get it. But knowing that that whole thing is going to be on there in being rescanned, that was pretty cool. And then also, what it doesn't talk about, too, is Jan had all those off-air films from missing episodes that were, was that done in New Zealand or Australia? I think it was New Zealand, right? That just had all these wonderful clips that we would never have seen again. They're the 8mm clips. And he had that, and he provided those as well. DWM 271 has a huge spread talking about this video release from Steve Roberts. It is very celebratory and is mentioned also in Shelf Life. It's really hard for people to appreciate that if you weren't there at the time. And this isn't a slam on anybody. But the idea that doing this release and having all these clips for so many of us may have only had them in very poor quality or not at all. And, if you got into this in 2005 when the new series came up, all this was out there in some form, but this is where it wasn't out there at all. And this was very cool. And once again, just another reason why this video is enormously nostalgic for me. So let's take a look at the video itself. This is probably one of the most unique box sets that we ever had on it. And this is during the time of Black Sheep. And I did give him a very hard time in the War Machine videos. This is no Alistair Pearson, that's for sure. But what this is, it works. For me, this works. There's no stupid Universal Galaxy swirl behind it. And yeah, it's once again floating heads. But the thing I like is using like this iconic photo of Bernard Breslau as the Ice Warrior. And I do have something about having iconic photos being part of the covers. And I have other people that I really work well with, admire, who always want to find different things for when they're doing a story on something, that they want to find different takes on it and stuff. And I understand that, and I appreciate that. But I feel like something like, the Ice Warrior photo here, the side profile, the Cyberman from 10th Planet, the shot of Hartnell wearing the French Revolution costume in the Reign of Terror, or even Tom Baker as Meglos. I want to see that imagery on the covers, because I always like to think that these are like the last versions of them. That's just how I feel about them. I think that they are, that there's a reason why some of these imagery exists. You see this also like on the Target novelization. So it comes in a cardboard box. It is a little flimsier than some of the other boxes that stuff comes in, but I think it kind of needs to because it's doing a lot of stuff. So you open it up, and on the inside here, you have Hartnell and Troughton, and it kind of it flaps open, if you will, and you have two VHSs in it, and they're in a slip cover. So you have the Ice Warriors, and then you have the Missing Years documentary on its own tape with Underwater Menace Episode 3. And, you know, this is very different for a PAL tape to have covers like this or cases like this. And as much as I like the Ice Warriors cover, and I do like the Ice Warriors cover, I really don't like the Missing Years cover. It's just like, why are they in fog? I don't understand. But even just like the back kind of gets me excited about the contents because all these wonderful imagery of, you know, basically missing episodes, which is what it's all about. And and then the front cover for the Ice Warriors, it's just, it does what it needs to do. Is it dynamic? No. But I don't mind it. I don't mind it as much. My box for this release was damaged when I got it. Mainly because of, you know, just packaging and stuff. I ordered it through Black Star. Anyone remember Black Star? This was once I got my PAL VCR, Black Star kind of had started roughly around that time, and it was an easy way to mail order PAL videos, PAL VHSs to the United States. Beforehand, you might have to go like through the Who shop and make special arrangements, call them up or something. This was all online. This is what they did. They sent it out. I think they sent it out from Ireland, actually. And I was able to get these wonderful videos. And I even used their finding service once to help me track down one of these videos that I could not find whatsoever. And we'll talk about that someday, hopefully. This showed up and it was damaged. Now, some of you had asked when I did the video, I think, for An Earthly Child, like a number of you actually had asked, how does that work with you having a PAL VCR? With the voltage and everything else. There's going to be, my next video, I'm going to tackle that because the story I'm going to do has very significance to that for me. I can imagine, unless I told you, I can imagine none of you will guess what the next video is going to be. But I'm going to be able, hopefully, to show a demonstration of not only how we converted from PAL to NTSC, but how we're able to do some rudimentary color adjustments to the recording as it was happening. I'm hoping that works out really well. I vividly remember getting this release, this release arriving in November, along with, of all things, my VHS of Men Behaving Badly, Jingle Balls. And I'm a big Men Behaving Badly fan. I'm not going to shy away from that. I actually got all the VHSs of it from where I worked at an advertising agency because they were hoping to kind of do some kind of campaign kind of based along that lad sort of culture. And they knew I had a PAL VCR and they wanted me to convert them. So they gave me all the tapes to Men Behaving Badly. And I converted them, and I fell in love with the show. And Jingle Balls was actually the first PAL Men Behaving Badly tape I actually had to order on my own because everything else was given to me. So it was really great, but I couldn't watch any of this. I had this wonderful release with the Missing Years documentary on it, and I couldn't watch it for a few days because it was the night of the groom's dinner for my sister's wedding, and then her wedding was the next day. Fantastic times, though. Fantastic memories. Just that whole weekend with this and everything else really takes me back. Now, any extras, you know, I have an area, like any extras on the VHS release. You know, I put that in to remind myself to talk about the Morris Berry interview, or, you know, like Attack of the Cybermen had a little bit from, I think, Blue Peter on it. You know, just little things. This release has to be the most extra-laden of all of them. It is. This is why this is such a fantastic release. And amongst them, as you know, is that over here on tape one, you get episodes 1, 4, 5, and 6 of the Ice Warriors. But along that, you get the an opening introduction by Fraser Hines and Deborah Watling from within the BBC archive, which is like, that's pretty cool. And that's just a kind of a precursor to what happens for the Missing Years documentary. And then you have episodes 2 and 3, a condensed version of them that includes shooting new material, like creating props and creating, you know, it's actually a television production along with the Telesnaps, along with a narration kind of in line to how, you know, like a transmission. I'm not a huge fan of it myself, but I appreciate why they did it and, you know, what they try to do. And, you know, there's people who like, you know, Loose Cannon or JV, they're creating full versions of the reconstructions. You know, when you're doing it on a more professional level, and I don't mean that they're not doing it well, but, you know, when there's somebody getting paid to do these, they're immediately going to be like, how do we do it so that it's not done just the way that everyone else is doing it? Whether that's successful or not doesn't matter, because they did it that way. So the cut down was necessary. Plus, you know, keeps it to a shorter tape. And knowing too, like now they include reconstructions onto the Blu-rays, but that's because you can pass forward, you can pass it up very easily. This you'd have to like fast forward. And it just didn't really work quite as well that way. So that's why they decided to kind of really keep this to an extreme cut-down version of episodes 2 and 3. Which is why, you know, you have that, and it's okay because you get the audio of the episodes as well on CD. And that's pretty neat. I think that's the first time that we got that. I think it's the first time we ever got officially released missing episode audio that was completely unaltered. No narration, no nothing. Just beautiful audio. And this is the VHS, or sorry, this is the CD for it. And I still love it. It's really, really very cool. And then, of course, you get this 48-page book that tells us about the Ice Warriors, the making of the Ice Warriors, how the Ice Warriors fit into the culture of Doctor Who from then, and it's really pretty cool. And I'm trying to think here. If it covers, well, I was going to say if it covers Big Finish, but it wouldn't cover Big Finish. Big Finish didn't start yet. So you have this, and it's just nice to have. And it's a lot of the new series books, or sorry, the Eighth Doctor books and the Past Doctor book had kind of a feel on the covers, and this has it. I love it. Then, of course, you have, moving over to tape number 2, you have the Missing Years documentary. Now, once again, you know, I hate to keep pulling the back in my day sort of routine here, but the idea of getting a documentary only about missing episodes blows my mind, because that just seems to be a very niche sort of thing, something I'm super interested in. But it's not just like, I mean, this is a very good documentary, going to a lot of different people to talk about how certain episodes were found. Fraser and Deborah Watling are in the BBC archive doing narration on it. It's very, very well done. Now we live in a time that, you know, we can have documentaries on basically everything in Doctor Who, which itself is very cool. Going from stuff that's very obvious, but so happy to have it, to stuff that's very niche and might make me scratch my head a little sometimes, but it doesn't matter because I don't have to watch it if I don't want to. But they do it now. But something like this, just specifically for the VHS releases, was pretty astounding. And I know some of you might be like, well, they did it for all those years tapes as well. They did. I think this is just, I think it's better produced, quite frankly. And better, just everything about it is better. And someday we'll get into this much more. But also on the tape, as we talked about, episode 3 of The Underwater Menace. I mean, it's just like, let's just keep filling up the tapes. I mean, this was very cool. It felt like that there was so much that they're trying to do. That you just have this beautiful set that came out. Just absolutely love it. And, you know, we talked about a couple things going on here. There was a time, right, in the early 90s, around 93, between 91 and 93, right, we started to get the Orphan episodes out on VHS with the Hartnell years, Troughton years, stuff like Dalek years, early years, Cybermen early years, the Invasion, and there was plans for all the other Orphan episodes to get a release, such as, I think we had talked about in the past how there might have been people thinking that Reign of Terror 4 and 5 existed, or that 10th Planet 4 existed. But they, regardless, they were on track to be released. So was the Ice Warriors back in the early 90s. And I think the links, as with everything, would have been handled by John Nathan Turner. And there was a fan outcry of not wanting to release those episodes because they were afraid what's going to happen when the episodes were found and we would have to buy them again. Oh, if that were the case, you know, boy, what a horrible thing that we'd have to deal with if that were the case. But that was a concern amongst vocal fans, and so the BBC dropped them. And I think the idea was, by 1998, that nothing was really being found in terms of full episodes. Boy, if we just kind of lived that way right now, and even up until 2024, and you know, it's like, well, we can't release the Ice Warriors because, you know, there's nothing new has been found. That'd been ridiculous. Thank goodness that this release happened, and I'm sure that it was Steve Cole and Steve Roberts and everyone else who kind of decided, let's do something like this, let's see how this works. And it worked very well, didn't it? And so for the restoration team, you know, obviously they put a lot of work into all of this. And talking about, like, if you go to their page, they still archive a lot of their articles that Steve had written about the releases. And the VHS releases, the stuff he wrote about the VHS releases are very interesting. And there's a lot of updates in there, kind of like what I did with DWM, that they had a lot of updates. What a great way to get people excited about this release. Because it's like, now we're doing this, now we're doing this, now we're doing this. Now we hear about everything when we have like a full press release. You know, think about now, the collection sets. There's like a small movie that's made whenever they're, you know, ready to roll. They have a very uniformed and a very successful launch for these. I'm not ripping on that. That's how it works, and it works very well. But back in the day when everything was just a little bit smaller, that there wasn't a whole big series that was, you know, it was leaning on, boy, it just seemed like, guess what? We're going to do this now, too. And now we found this, and we got the Galaxy 4 clips, and that was really cool. And I do miss those days. And I'll be perfectly honest. At the time of doing this, the season 15 collection has been announced. I don't get excited about these things anymore. I don't, you know, it's like I have them all on DVD. The Blu-ray, the HD, they do look very nice, especially stuff that originates on 2-inch videotape. But, you know, more often than not, when it comes to archival stuff, we have seen it already, and very little of it actually excites me anymore. And so I think about these periods, this time, when it was so much different and so much more unique. And that is something that I kind of feel bad about, but at the same time, how many times does this stuff get released that I'm going to be excited about kind of the same content? I'm excited for it. Do I support it? 100%. I buy everything. And I will continue to do so. But, you know, it just doesn't hold the same excitement as something like this back in the day. Like, wow, I can't believe we're getting all this. And knowing full well that, you know, Doctor Who was very niche back in the 90s because there wasn't a whole lot that was holding the brand together apart from some people who believed that it could be a good moneymaker, and they rewarded their followers with really good quality materials and products. Of course, the one piece to that is always, you know, you have the restoration team delivering these wonderful restored, beautiful for the time episodes. And then you'd have the Sony Sprinter VHS duplicators in the UK mess it all up. And I can't remember, and I meant to actually message Steve to remind me what the issue was, but there is an issue with the Ice Warriors set, with the tapes being so poorly duplicated. And that's just like, we talked about that in the Five Doctors as well. It's like, just when you're trying to get things to look their best, that downstream of the workflow, you have no control over it, and they mess it up. And that just feels bad. One last thing from the restoration team is that they also had endorsed somebody to make a cover for the CD. Because maybe you do not want the Ice Warriors just to be in a plastic sleeve in your VHS box. Maybe you want to put it in a jewel case and put it on the shelf. And they had one that somebody put together. And they fully endorsed that one. So my opinion of this release, obviously, is pretty high. This is nostalgia for me. You know, normally I'm able to talk about what the PBS stations did and stuff. I don't have any of that for this. Didn't run on any PBS stations. But what we do have is I have so many great memories of the people who put this together. I have so many memories of myself and close friends excited about what we're going to get and what's this going to look like, and Ice Warriors in really nice quality to, at the time, the best quality we could possibly get. And that was pretty cool. Even the U.S., you know, they didn't do the box, but they had their version of it as well. And they included the CD. They included the book, which neither... Oh, the book is in here. I couldn't find the book at first. I thought that was gone. My CD went walkies. I just opened this recently, actually. What's missing from here, though, is the Missing Years documentary. And it's really interesting. It was really interesting that they did that. You know, on the back, they show us what's included with everything. This is in a clamshell case that doesn't really fit with everything else. You might say, well, nor does the Ice Warrior box set. It does. It's the same height as everything behind me. It fits very well into the collection overall. This is just kind of like, you know, the big brother, big dopey brother. Hi, I'm here with the rest of the VHSs. The Missing Years documentary doesn't make its appearance until the Edge of Destruction VHS comes out. We talked about the beginning box set in the UK for the VHS that never happened. In the US, Unearthly Child, the Daleks, did not get a remastered re-release, but The Edge of Destruction did get a release because it wasn't released before. That also included the pilot. And then the second tape was The Missing Years, as well as the third episode of The Underwater Menace. Interesting how all that stuff works out. And of course, not only those, but then of course we have the DVD release as well. And, you know, it goes to show how far we've come between 1998 and like 2013 or something like that when this came out, that we had animated episodes for episodes 2 and 3. Animated episodes kind of in line with how we were going to animate The Reign of Terror for the BBC. Oh, you didn't know I was going to animate The Reign of Terror for BBC, or that there was even a possibility of that. We'll have to do a Reign of Terror video at some point, I suppose. That being said, let's take a look, as we often do, at the comparisons between these episodes of The Ice Warriors. Let's do the NTSC video of it. Let's take a look at the PAL video and then the DVD to see how far we've come.
So much for your word.
That was not planned.
I have one major requirement. The mercury isotopes for my ship's reactor. You will give them to me.
But we don't use mercury isotopes.
The doctor stated that you had them here.
He was wrong, we have none.
And then of course someday there'll be a Blu-ray. And that will look pretty awesome too. I think the stuff that was from Film Source that had been rescanned for HD, such as the Time Meddler on the collection set, season 2, is phenomenal. And people are like, well, there's all those lines in it. Yeah, they're scan lines. It just goes to show how good of a recording that is. Sorry you don't like it. Please, please, BBC Studios, do not listen to the people who don't like it. Keep them that way. Thank you. Okay, got that off my chest. But also, once again, if you like what I'm doing here, if you think that this, you know, these videos have any purpose, please consider joining my Patreon. I would really like to get at least one new member every time a video came on, because these mean a lot to me, and it just shows that people really want to support them. And in fact, a number of people have. Let's take a look to see who's been supporting me on Patreon. Thank you to all of them. I really do appreciate it. And folks, if you don't support me in Patreon, please know I do appreciate you as well. Everyone who gives their opinion, their feedback, everything else like that, please know I do appreciate that. Obviously, would I like to see some more people on the Patreon? Yes. But I also don't mean to say anything other than thank you to everyone who has been so kind as we do these videos. Once again, if you have anything you want to say to me, if I got something wrong or you want to correct or want to share your story, definitely you can go to YouTube, leave a comment there. You also subscribe, please, to my channel. But also, you can send me feedback at the email address below. I can be slow to respond, but it don't mean that I don't want to respond. I just love everybody's take on what we're talking about here. Once again, I love doing these. It's been so much fun to kind of open up that treasure chest of memories and remember how fun it was for the first time to get some of these releases and all the stories that go along with them. I hope we continue for a very, very long time.
And there are more space adventures on these BBC videos with Patrick Troughton, the second incarnation of Doctor Who.